That's all I wanted. So what happened was, I remember my mom came and visited me in Chicago many years to that day, where I used to watch these YouTube videos on how to wear makeup, how to cover scars, how to, you know, just sort of get back into the real world without having to feel embarrassed or feel smaller or feel unvalidated, because it can really change the way you see yourself and the world. You know, the kind of relationships you make, the kind of validation you look for. You've got to have that all in place as you're growing up. You know, you can't spend your life feeling like lesser than somebody else. And that was the biggest struggle. So what I do, and even to this day, is when I enter a new place, okay, I will go and check out the stairs beforehand. I know where the stairs are. I go the night before. I came here also last night to see where the stairs are here. Because you see, I always wear 5-inch heels, only because I'm love them. Okay, can I see the distance between myself and the floor? I can't. Who cares? See, that's the only way to live it. Don't accept. I don't accept it. I'm just like, okay, so if I have to play it safe and be like, oh, okay, all this has happened to me, I can't see anything, I'm going to wear flats. What's the fun in life? Tell me. Okay, so like my shoes always defy any kind of gravity. Always. So it's like people always ask me, are you nuts? I'm like, no, this is just me. So it's, but there are some things that I have to, I've got to, some of the things that I wanted to share before, I don't know where I am on time, so I'm okay. So some of the things I wanted to share is, as I have a brother who actually took a step back when I needed all this attention from my parents. It took a lot out of him. He's younger than me. He's 3 years younger than me. And for a younger sibling to take a step back and be okay with the other sibling take over and eclipse their life for that much time takes a lot of strength. I don't know if I appreciated then, but I do appreciate it now. And for my mother, and I know, like I said, it's a story by itself, is that the guilt that comes with, oh my God, I put her in the car. It overwhelms me. It is never anybody's fault. It's all very good for me to say now 15 years later, which is just like, okay, I get it. But what about what consumed all of us at night when we were all four in different places? I was in a hospital bed, she was in a hospital bed, my dad was on a plane, and my brother was in boarding school. And this is how we lived for many, many years, trying to still relate to one another. And for me, the biggest challenge for me, or at least now I think I have a handle on it, is not to be envious of the rest of the world. I can't get angry that somebody else can drive, and I can't. I can just be happy that my drive was pretty cool, right? So, it takes, for example, the University of Chicago was never an easy curriculum. It's like a lot of studying. It's like the hardest school in the world, I'd say. So I used to do it with audiobooks, or ask my teachers to blow up my font to 22 point. The one thing that I learned the most is never to have people feel sorry for you, because that is never the point, and that's never the reason. And once you go down that road, there's no coming back. Pity is not the way to go. Just empower yourself and just know that there's a purpose for every one of us, as I found mine, and I'm still finding it. So what happened was, I finished my undergrad and I tried to keep, like, to focus on my story and not, get into, oh, she looks like that, or that was, or try to associate with people, because when I was younger, I used to try to associate with what I thought was beautiful. Trying to be around people that were beautiful, just because it would make me feel better about myself. That is like the human being needing validation, we all do. And I think that's something that needs to be kept in check. That's something that I learned, definitely learned the hard way. So when I completed my undergraduate in the US 2007, I came back, and actually I was an RJ on 104.8 at the time. So we have something in common. So I came back, and it had been a fair amount of time since the accident happened. It was a very high profile event, because my family itself has been in the fashion industry for a very long time. So everyone wants to, and the human spirit is such that they want to know what went wrong with you. They want to hear the sordid details. They want to know how much you cried. They want to know how much it hurt. Do they really want to know how much you succeeded? There are a few. Not everybody. It's the how much you cried story that, like, gets the most hits, unfortunately. And I'm in digital now, so I should know. It's but what happened was, when I came back, I was much more whole as a person in terms of understanding what my path was, being okay with my face, being okay that it is yet going to change moving forward, and that I'm ready to tell my story. So that 2007, 8 and 9, while I was 1 and 4.8, I worked with Initrate for a short period of time, but then decided to get into media for 2 or 3 years. And you know, I think I needed to just prove to myself that I was beautiful. I think that was it. I think I needed to see it. So I was like, okay, let's tell the story. Fine. So I did a whole bunch of wonderful shoots, magazine covers. I started to get to know the new Anjali. And now there is no new and old. This is just it. That is like maybe if my mother remembers her version. So that's for her to know. But for me, this is, I started to embrace my face. I started to embrace my body. I started to embrace the fact that it's okay that I don't have like 20/20 vision. In fact, far from it. But, you know, I can still have more than a zest for life than maybe the other person. And that I can continue to be somebody that my parents are proud of. And not some kind of write-off, you know. So what happened was, I did a story. I remember, it's such a surreal experience. I told my story to Savvy in April of 2009, I believe. And someone called me from Bombay and said they were driving down Marine Drive and saw a huge big hoarding with my face on it. A huge one. It was, they called me and I'm just like, seriously? And they took like a picture and sent it. And there was actually this huge big hoarding of me in the middle of the most fast-paced city in India. So stuff, good stuff happened. So when that, all of that happened, I mean, I needed to give back. I needed to close that loop as to why has this happened. Are there people I can connect with? I did a lot of colleges. I toured colleges. I spoke to students. I spoke to there are kids out there like committing suicide for bad marks and all. I'm like, please, perspective, okay? So it's like, come on. So I've done Trichy and all of that. It was really entertaining. I've even told this. This is like a very a sophisticated version of the speech. I told it in Tamil also. That was hard. But it was a really a wonderful 3 years for me to get to know myself and be okay with it. And then I finished that, and then I needed to go back and study some more. I felt like my love was not in front of the camera. I spent 3 years in front of it, did all the posing and the training, and then I was done. So then I really felt I wanted to get into PR and corporate communication and all of that. So now I'll fast forward a little bit. So then I moved, I went back to the US, I went to New York, I went to the Stern School and studied my MS in PR and corporate communication. I in fact had some wonderful internships while studying. In 2002, I managed the Jamaican team when they took part in the Olympics. So I did the PR for Johan Blake and Usain Bolt when they won. And imagine that, I mean, while, you know, from like, Parvale Pavel, hey, Usain Bolt is my friend now. So it's it was a great experience, and New York was tough. It was tough because I was studying and working at the same time. And there I can't be like, oh, I can't see and I can't get on the bus and stuff. I was living on the same budget as anybody else, making the same money as anybody else, and had to pay the same obnoxious tuition fee as everybody else. So it was, but it pushed me. And that's what I love about that city. It made me cognizant of what I'm truly capable of. And not live in what I don't have, but as opposed to live in what I do. So then I came back from New York and started Touche PR, which was mentioned earlier. It was a PR company that I started. And I did that for 3 years. And had a wonderful time, I must say. I had a lot of support from my parents working in the PR industry in Chennai. And then last year, my father and I had the big conversation because, like I mentioned before, Indian Terrain is part of our family business. And I have rejoined that, hopefully to be the scale of the future. And take over, I now run the entire digital and the e-commerce of the company with a 15% revenue target for 2021. So the conversations that I've had truly over the last 15 years have changed year on year. Okay? But first we're bleeding about like, oh my God, what has happened? Because people ask me like, what kind of relationship do I have with my face? It's always changing. How I looked in 2006 is not how I will look now, and I will look different in 10 years. I need to be okay with that. So the whole concept, and beauty is such a central theme to any of to existence in our country, especially, you know, when it comes to a girl getting married or all that kind of stuff. I would like to see which guy will deal with this, because it'll be a heck of a challenge. So it's very interesting for me to live here and do the work that I do. But I think a lot of the lessons that I've learned have helped me stay focused. I'm pretty much now fully involved in growing the business, and I am, I think, hopefully scheduled for another surgery at the end of the year. We need to get a little bit of nip tuck. And I try to see the lighter side of life, because that's all there is for you to see anyway. You know, it's just like, either, you know, I can make fun of it and say, hey, I had a lip job, which I didn't, by the way, and nothing else also, only the necessary stuff, but who's to say? And I truly, who I am now and why I agreed to come and speak to others is because I'm peaceful with it, and I still have so much more to do. I mean, if it sounds like a lot, this is barely anything, because I still want to go do my MBA, and hopefully be my dad is a Harvard alumni, so my hope is to end up going there and do a whole bunch of stuff, see a lot of places in the middle of all this craziness. And I forgot this to tell you, I went and lived in Mexico for 7 months, okay, for 7 months in the middle, and this is still while adjusting to everything. I found a one-way ticket to Guadalajara down south. My mother was not pleased with that, so I disconnected my cell phone. I put them through a bit, okay. I'll be honest, I disconnected my cell phone in the US, found a one-way ticket down to, I mean, not in Mexico City. Mexico City, you can find me. Guadalajara, who knows where it is? It's like south. And I lived with a host family who didn't speak English. So that's the only way to learn Spanish anyway. And I lived there for 7 months, learned how to dance. I can do the salsa, merengue, bachata. I haven't found any good dancers here, so if any of you are up for it, please let me know. We can talk after. And but I feel like this experience of mine was very freeing. Because I didn't have anyone to impress. I only had to be okay with me. And this relationship that I have with myself is truly what anchors me, anchors my family, and I believe is what motivates me to build a story that matters. Because there has to be a reason, right? For every one of us, there has to be a reason. I believe this is mine. So with those few words, I will, hopefully I've done justice.